Penguin Random House Canada presents an audio production of The Kite by W.O. Mitchell, abridged and read for you by the author.
My name is W.O. Mitchell. This novel is called The Kite. It concerns the oldest man in the world, John Felix Sherry. He's 111 years old, and in the course of this novel, he is being interviewed by a reporter from Toronto named David Lang. The first 8 years of David Lang's life had been spent in a foothills town, perhaps 100 miles removed from Shelby, the home of John Felix Sherry. The next 9, he had lived in the city to which his mother had moved at the death of his father. There was money from the sale of his father's shop and what was left of the insurance, and she started a boarding house. Lon Burke was his mother's star boarder, and Lon had a heart condition. David had been told, both by his mother and by Lon himself, who had explained, that he must carry his pills with him at all times. Nitroglycerin, boy. That's the stuff they make explosives out of, you know. He showed them to David, tiny and white, and not dangerous looking at all. One spring evening, Lon had made him a kite. Hunched over the kitchen table, David beside him with chin in his hands, watching every single move. Can't be out of hair, boy. Gotta balance even, just like a teeter-totter, with two boys the same weight to the ounce on each end of her. When Lon had found the precise center, he marked it with a pencil, bound it to the upright stick, and began to outline the diamond with a string. You know, they got whistling kites, these here China natives. Hang a bamboo flute onto her, and she sings with the wind. Anchor the kite string to their house roof. Keep her flying night and day. Why? Well, hanging up there hooting like that, they figure it keeps the evil spurts off. There's some natives that worships kites. Somewhere's around Australia or New Zealand, around there. They sing hymns to their kites whilst they're climbing up. He spread the paper out on the table, placed the finished stick and string skeleton on it. He let David mix up the flour and water paste in a cup. Once, he said, a general had won a whole war because of a kite. Used to lay string across a river for the seed of a bridge that had won him a decisive battle. There's fighting kites too, boy. How do they fight, Lon? With their string stiffened and glue and ground glass, and they swoop them over to another kite so as their string alongside the other kite's string, and then they jerk back and forth till she saws right through. Oh, there's lots of things to do with a kite besides flying them. You know, kid, you can send up messages. Just a piece of paper split to a little hole. The wind spins her round and round, so she travels right up till she gets to the kite. You can cut the paper now. Leave a good inch around her. Lots of edge to fold over and paste. We don't want her coming apart in a strong wind. When they had finished pasting the paper over the frame, Lon lifted it down from the table and stood it on its end. Hey, it's as tall as you are, boy. It was, for the cross stick came just up to his nose. Gee, it didn't take long to build. She not finished yet. She has to have a tail. As they twisted paper and half-hitched it into the tail string, Lon explained its function. Can't have her too long or too short. If she's too long, won't fly. Oh, she'll fly all right, but sort of dead and sluggish. She won't dive and dash and do acrobatics. You want her to dance, don't you, boy? Oh, yeah. I want her to dance. All right, then. Mustn't have the tail too long, nor too short either. What happens if she's too short? It'll only go up 20 or 50 feet. Then she goes wild, right out of control. She'll dive, maybe get her balance, go too far to the other side, head straight for the ground, whang her nose right into the dirt, and snap her back. No, tail's important, boy. Now, we'll make her so's we know she's too long and draggy, but when we get her out to fly, we'll keep breaking off a piece at a time till we have her just right. David could hardly support school the next day. He ran almost the whole way home, burst through the front door, raced up the stairs and down the hall to Lon's room. Hey, Lon, let's go, Lon! Hold on, boy. Are we going to fly her? Sure we are. Now? No, not today. But you got the string, didn't you? You said you'd get... Oh, I got a mile of string. Then why aren't we going to... We can't fly her in the city, boy. Cities ain't for flying kites in. We got to ride out to the city limits where there's space. Kite needs elbow room where she won't get tangled up in telephone wires and power lines and where she's free of buildings. Oh, we got to wait till Saturday. Oh, Lon. See, it still gets dark early, boy. We wouldn't have time to get out to the city limits and fly her any length of time before dark. Doesn't get dark all that early. Doesn't take all that time to ride the streetcar to the city. We can't make it today, David. What about tomorrow? That's a school day, son. We got early closing tomorrow. School lets out at 3 instead of 4. Does it? Yeah. Our class hasn't had anybody late all month. That means we get out an hour early, and 3 o'clock would give us time, wouldn't it? Sure it would. You come straight home tomorrow. We'll take the Norwood streetcar and we'll fly her tomorrow. Lon, yes. Could I be all right if I kept her in my room? In there on your bed now, and the string's there too. But they hadn't flown the kite the next day, for at noon, Norman Laycock slid into his seat 7 minutes late to ruin the class record for the month. Miss Calman seemed to feel just as bad about it as the class, for she told them to put away their books while she read to them in the hour they were not free in early closing. David made plans for Norman Laycock for coming in late, hardly listening to the whining of Black Beauty through 3 whole chapters. Lon tried to cheer him up. Don't you worry, boy. Tomorrow's Saturday. We'll catch that Norwood streetcar right after breakfast. We'll be out there and she'll be tugging at her string. Even before David had opened his eyes the next morning, he heard the rain on the roof, the first real one of spring. It filled him with infinite sadness when it had not lit up by noon. He spent the rest of the day in the room with the kite, at first trying to hold it by the upright stick to make it swoop in pretended flight. It was too big and awkward for that, and he laid it across the bed and looked at it. But Sunday morning, he and Lon walked to the streetcar stop through a washed and sunlit day. Lon let him go ahead while he put in their tickets, and they sat in the smoking section across the back so David could let the kite stick out into the aisle before himself. He felt a bit of regret as they passed a church corner and he saw people trickling down the street toward the open church doors. Ordinarily, he'd be in a suit and headed for Sunday school now. As the streetcar crossed the city, it made hardly any stops, and there was no clanging of the bell, almost as though it went through a silent run with only half a mind, the proper way for a streetcar on a Canadian Sunday. "We're here, Lon, we're here!" The streetcar had stopped at a little shed, just a roof on posts with the back filled in. Ahead, the tracks made a figure eight. With a slow fist, Lon was striking himself on the side of his chest. "What's wrong, Lon?" Still, the old man did not answer, and still the fist kept up its deliberate and gentle thumping.
"The explosion pills.
David pushed the kite aside, fumbled under the old man's suit coat and into the lower vest pocket.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.